Hello, everyone. Welcome. How many people were in the last session? Show of hands. Look at that.
Wow.
That's a lot of people.
Stamina.
That's a ton of people. How many people here work in the film or television business? Show of hands. Oh, my. Okay. How many folks are just here for the film festival looking at films and thought, hey, what a cool panel to go see and aren't in the film business?
None.
One! Congratulations. Dogpile. All right. Well, welcome. My name's Mike Rohl, and I'm going to be the moderator on the panel today. And obviously, this is the TV Director Essentials panel. And first of all, I want to thank everybody for coming to this panel. I'd like to thank the Vancouver Film Festival and Fran and all the organizers for putting together this panel and also bringing together what I think is a very, very cool panel of directors that we can learn a lot from. And also, thank you so much to the Directors Guild of Canada. Directors Guild of Canada for sponsoring this ultra cool event. Very cool event. Okay, we have an opportunity here, and actually a very good opportunity here, because this panel of people here are television directors, but we also get the benefit of the fact that they also have major experience in a lot of the other branches of the production, film and television tree, that I think we'll be able to take advantage of today to give ourselves extra perspective on what we do as television directors, different points of view, and I think that'll be very valuable, and I'm sure a lot of you can share some of that insight as we go through, okay? First of all, I think I'll introduce who our panel are, just to get to know them a little bit. Down at the end there, we have Jason Bourque. Jason, big hand for Jason, yes. Jason's got some pretty cool credits here. He's got a lot of feature documentary work that he's done, and I'm sure that'll come up in the panel discussing that kind of experience and how it affects your television experience. He did Shadow Company, Dreams of Flight, Darwin's Brave New World, Music for Mandela, some really cool documentaries. And then I noticed on your bio, you said there's something really, really cool there that in the last 66 years, 18 of his scripts have been produced. So you're a very prolific writer as well, which I find very impressive.
It keeps me busy. It's good to have the directing skills and then being able to branch out when things kind of slow a little bit. So
great plan.
Yeah.
Great plan. And also, you have a feature film in the festival right now, don't you? Blackfly.
I do, Blackfly. And we had two sold-out shows, and the audience has been wonderful and blessed that we had very strong feedback. I was very nervous going into that one. We didn't do any test audiences, so this was it.
Wow.
It was VIFF.
Awesome. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Next, we have Lynne Stopkewich. Lynne's a very, very well-known director, both in Canada and outside of Canada. She did some feature films when I was first breaking in the business. I think you were, too, at around the same time. And some of your movies that you first came off with were, I love them. And they're, just to remind you what they are, they were Kissed, was one of her first films, Suspicious River, Lilith on Top, some really great work there. She's been recently doing a lot of work as a producer for other people's feature films, which was a cool branch off. And then as far as television is concerned, let me see what you've been up to now lately. Oh, The L Word, fantastic show. The Firm, Rookie Blue, the TV film The Life, and then most recently Signed, Sealed, and Delivered for the lovely Martha Williamson, who's a very good showrunner. Next, we have Adam Arkin, who I have to mention actually agreed to come to our panel at the last second. Unfortunately, and this is classic, we had a panelist shooting in New Orleans, and what do you think is going to happen? Shooting live, it's Friday. Think about it. Friday night shooting, Vancouver, New Orleans. Unfortunately, something happened. He wasn't able to attend, but Mr. Arkin has been very, very gracious to come and fill in for him. So thank you very much, Adam. And Adam's work is quite extensive. He's a director. His most recent credits have been on Backstrom, which you're working on right now in Vancouver, Masters of Sex, The Bridge, Justified, Extant. Nurse Jackie, Sons of Anarchy, and The Americans. He's also you were producing on The Americans as well.
First season,
season. And then an extensive and wonderful list of achievements in the acting realm, including Hitch, The Bridge, Masters of Sex, Justified, Sons of Anarchy, Life, Eight Simple Rules, Baby Bob, and of course, Chicago Hope. Fantastic show. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. So he's been a very, very prolific and busy man. So thank you again for coming to the panel. And then, And Scott Smith, who, again, is another well-known Canadian director here and abroad, and some fantastic feature films that you've done also, including Roller Coaster, Falling Angels. Did you write those as well?
Yeah, I wrote Roller Coaster. Falling Angels was based on a Barbara Gowdy novel.
Okay, cool. So more writing. That's cool. And as well as the documentary, As Slow as Possible. That's cool. And then most recently in television, Skins, Out in Halifax for Call Me Fitz, and Signed, Sealed, and Delivered, which he was also the producer director of. And that's the show you just recently finished. He's my boss. He's my boss. Nice guy. Okay. All right, so just before I open up the questioning, I just wanted to identify what the goal of this talk is going to be, the way we're hoping that we can do. And most of you guys have a lot of experience, but we're hoping to, for those that want to get a little more information, just be able to pull the curtain back a little bit and get more specific detail on exactly what a television director does, the responsibilities, the challenges, some of the technical and artistic skills that you should have in your toolbox, as it's described, as well as just the mindset of a successful TV director. How should you think to be successful in the television industry? And then also, I think if we have time, to just touch on our role as television directors in the modern hierarchy of television production and how it is these days, because it's different than it used to be. We're now entered the golden age, or the second golden age of television, and our roles inside there are pretty specific, and so we thought maybe eventually you could bring up. It's probably going to come up during some of our discussion anyways. Okay? So with that said, I'll open it up, and anybody can kind of jump on this. Being at a film festival, the term director comes up, and quite often when one thinks of a director, they usually align that with their perception of a feature film director, long-form director, and what they would imagine the responsibilities are in that form. So with television directing, I'll throw it out to the panel, is there a difference between what a feature director does and what a television director does, and what are the specifics of those differences?
On the floor, I don't think there's much of a difference at all. During production, your job is still to show up and communicate to 60 to 100 people, whether you're telling or working with actors to stage it, whether you're working with props department to tell the story with the prop, the energy that goes into that hour and a half, 2 hours for that scene is exactly the same as the energy that goes into the 3 hours you have to shoot that scene in a low budget feature. So this is probably from low budget features. What's different for me is in prep. In feature prep, your prep is much longer. If you've been writing the script, you've really absorbed it in a way. So I find the big differences are in prep, not so much on the floor.
I see. Cool.
And time.
Yeah, although I'm coming from low budget, I've only gotten 3 more days to shoot a feature than I would have got to shoot 2 episodes of television, or 4 more days. So it's and I'm much faster now than I was when I shot those features. So I've always kind of treated it as somewhat equal. I've never had an 80-day shoot. I've had a 20-day shoot, a 23-day shoot, and a whole bunch of 14 and 15-day shoots. Not that much different. And I've gotten better as I got older at being able to do stuff quicker. I probably would have shot double what I shot on those features now. But the time I don't find actually that different. I feel like the job is relatively the same.
Maybe it's the fact that you don't get that same amount of prep time.
Like yeah,
perhaps when you're writing, usually on features, you've probably been developing the material for a long period of time, been involved with that material. For me, my own experience with television has been to really kind of jump on a moving train. You know, I might get hired on a show that's been going for a few years, so it's really up to me to do all the homework. And I actually do that. I'll go and I'll watch. Like the first time I did Da Vinci's Inquest, unfortunately, it was their 5th season. So I watched 5 years of the show without telling anyone because I was kind of like, oh man, she's the nerd. But I did. I watched everything because I thought, how am I going to direct Nick Campbell on? Like, what insight am I going to give to Nick Campbell in his 5th year of working on this character? So I watched everything thinking that through line was something that could help me, in terms of where we were in that particular episode at that particular time. So I think it's that prep that on features you really get that chance to be immersed in the material from the inception, you know, how people are thinking about it, where it came from, all the way to the floor. Whereas in TV, for me, sometimes it's like, I'm the person who probably knows the least. It's trying to catch up the quickest, trying to meet everybody, remember everybody's name, connect with everyone, and do it all as quickly as I can so that I feel that I'm actually not only fitting in, but I'm actually bringing something interesting to the team.
In TV, you put on the costume of the show. In features, you build the costume and then you put it on.
Yeah.
I was going to say, to add to that, the perspective shift, knowing that when you do a feature, it's going to be you're the captain of the ship, and the producers are essentially there to protect you and to hold that creative vision of the director up high. Whereas when I'm working for other producers on television, it's very much, I want to get that next job. I'm thinking of being a bit more of a yes man, so to speak, because you do want to form those relationships and literally go on to the next gig. So for me, again, a little bit of a perspective shift. Mm.
It's an odd dynamic having to be the captain of the ship, per se, and an outsider at the same time. And it's tough to navigate. And I think there's another element that comes into it, which is I haven't done a lot of long form stuff, but the first season of The Americans and the one long form thing I did do, I was involved in the putting together of a crew. And there's just automatically a different dynamic with a group of people who know that they're there partially because you advocated for their presence. And the level of cooperation you get and enthusiasm you get, I think, changes. And as an outsider with a vast crew of people, it's up to you to kind of ingratiate yourself as an episodic director and figure out people's methods of working as opposed to vice versa.
Interesting, yeah. So it is quite a bit different than the parameters you'd get on a feature film, for sure. Now, considering most of us in the audience are part of the business, it's no secret that in the modern day of television production, that the showrunner is a writer's medium, and that the creative epicenter of all that is represented in the role of the showrunner, who oftentimes, not always, but oftentimes, are the people that create the show and become the central creative lens that everything, all the choices that are made creatively go through to ensure that the quality and the integrity of the original vision is made. We're all pretty clear about that. So if we were to flip it a little bit and do a little mini role play here, if any of you folks were, let's say, a showrunner of a show, and you wanted to invite some directors on your show to tell your story, what is it you would want from them?
That's a good question, but Scott, you probably have a good answer for that, because I did, similar to Mike, I was in the team, the four directors did this series, and Scott was also producer on it, and it's the first time on any series where I was brought in, where all the directors got together, where the showrunner gave us the entire arc for the season, included us, so it was the four directors, the actors, and the showrunner, and the producer all in a room, and she basically outlined the whole season for us. And right before that happened, Scott got together with just the directors and kind of gave us a little bit of the lowdown, because he had shot the pilot, so he was telling us about the set and things that we would want to sort of keep our ears open to. So I think for me, if I was a showrunner, I would want to try and get those directors hired as early as I could, rather than kind of just picking up the phone, oh, we've got a spot that's open. But sort of know who you want to have for your whole season, who are the right people for which episodes, if you have that luxury and you know that far in advance. Mm-hmm. But include them in the process, because I found it was really helpful for me going to the floor, knowing what was coming before, even if the scripts weren't written yet. And I could also, the other luxury was, I just decided, because I felt like I was part of the team, I would just go hang out. Like, usually you don't work on a show until your actual prep starts. But I just started hanging out. Like, I'd go and I'd watch Scott on the floor. And it's very rare that you get to see another director work. And it was great, because I could see what the relationship with the actors was, how the crew was working. They got to see my face. He introduced me to people. So you really felt, Scott, you kind of created a almost like a feature film vibe, but, you know, the four-headed monster, four directors, yet you invited us to that party, and I think that really made a difference. So I think it's something that I would try to do if I could. I know it's probably difficult to
I'm spit on this because I know what I don't feel like that is a traditional showrunner thing to do. And I was still in that capacity working for the showrunner for Martha.
And
you hear lots about what showrunners want. So I'm still kind of keeping that over here. And like, oh yeah, most showrunners they want a bunch of different options. They want the only thing they really want is not to have to sit down in the edit room and go, can I have this? And have the editor say no because they didn't shoot it. That's all you ever really hear. And yet at the same time, if it was my show. Yeah. And I was bringing the directors on. I'd like, make sure you get enough coverage and all that kind of stuff. But actually, what I really, really want is I want your take. Because if you hose everything down, if you give me a million different angles of the same thing, but there's no take on the scene, there's no, bon mot, there's no note that gets hit somewhere, then it's just going to go by. And yeah, as the showrunner, I might have all the options I want, but it's still just going to go by. So I don't know what the answer is to that. I know a lot of showrunners just want you to get them the coverage and give them options, but there's a part of me that goes, well, the director needs to, elevate it. He needs to be the person that says this moment in this scene is the thing that turns it all around, and I'm going to get that moment, and I got an idea for this moment, and all those things. That's what creates good television, is something that gets inspired from the script. It becomes, it's not coverage. So I don't know what the right answer to that is.
That's a pretty good answer, I think. I think really by asking that question of directors, it really gets you to kind of think in the other person's shoes, because it's their thing. How I'm going to have to pick you, and you're going to have to support the vision. What's the skill set that would be required for that? And I think you've hit a pretty good point.
Yeah, it depends. I'm sure showrunners in the room going, no, it's going to be covered.
On the bridge, yeah. Elwood Reed, the showrunner on the bridge, it was a unique experience with him. But before I started the first episode I did with him, he took me aside right before we started shooting and said, do not worry about giving me material to change what you want to do with this. Tell your story and take chances and shoot things in masters. You don't have to overcover stuff. Just exactly what you were saying, just have an idea of the story you want to tell and do it boldly, and we'll worry about the rest. And it was very empowering.
Cool, very cool. And Jason, in the MOW world, which is a slight hybrid, isn't it, of long form and episodic?
It is.
You're dealing though with like the studio or a network or a distributor.
Usually a whole lot of people, but I find I'm just thinking from taking the perspectives what you guys are talking about. Like if I was looking at hiring a director, I it's almost like hiring an actor for me, because I'm very collaborative is my style. So I would definitely be going for someone I know that literally has the communication skills and can. Also, just be, again, very collaborative and very teamwork orientated. Just very briefly, I can remember a showrunner giving me a job. I had done only sci-fi, and it was a comedy series, and I literally got the job because I told a very funny story, and I made him laugh. And he had seen all the other villains, all the usual suspects in town, and it was because I could tell a funny little warped story. Mm-hmm. Very briefly, I'm a Maritimer. It was like 16 below. I was 14 at a funeral back east, the snow was falling, they brought out a coffin, it was a metal coffin. And this 80-year-old lady, and I know it's a funeral, and this poor 80-year-old grandmother bent down and kissed the lid of the coffin. And her face froze to the lid. And it was a lot of people think that's horrible, but they loved it and they laughed, and I got the gig the next day. And it was just because I told that one story. It had nothing to do with the fact I've never done comedy.
And I'm seeing that story. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's so good. Okay, so let's get into some nitty gritty here. That's sort of the broad strokes of kind of where we sit in the hierarchy of things. Let's say you've been hired for the show. They flew you in. Maybe it's business class. Maybe not.
Business class.
We don't know.
Okay. I haven't flown business class since I worked for the airline.
And you get there, and you've been given your script, and you meet some folks in the office. Let's talk about prep. And what I'm curious about is how you would describe your approach to prep as far as an episode or an MOW, let's say, if you're fortunate enough to get that? And how does the genre affect that prep? And or if it's a procedural show or a show that leans more to serial, what are some of the tools that you like to use in prep to get ready for the shoot?
Blundstone boots.
Yeah, we're all wearing that.
The first thing you have, you must make sure you have at all times.
Actually, the best advice I ever got from a director who'd been working for years was, make sure you change your socks at lunch. And the other one, Scott, you told me, was from Norman Jewison saying, the first thing you got to do is drive a wedge between the camera operator and the DP.
Nice.
Which I always thought was really funny.
The first thing you got to do in the voice, the first thing you got to
do is drive a wedge.
If that wedge isn't already there.
For sure.
I don't know. For me, I'm very much about getting as much information as I can, as quickly as I can when I start prep. Everything from trying to figure out who's who, who's working with who, what people want, basically. It's like my time to kind of take in as much information, because once I'm on the floor, that's when I have to actually make those decisions. But I also feel like with television, my job is to really execute the vision of the showrunner and the producers more than anything, and to bring some of my own thing to the table. I mean, obviously I'm being hired for a reason, but I always want to ask why. Like, what was it in me that they wanted? Or I try to find out how that came about, because sometimes it's just a phone call out of the blue from your agent saying, you know, they'd like you to do this show, are you available? So really, I try to get as much information. And one of my best experiences with that was when I first started out, I was working on The L Word, and it was the first season, and the producer was very green. And you know how we all have these things called tone meetings that are usually in the prep, where you do all your prep, you find your locations, you're doing your casting, and then there's this thing called the tone meeting. And I never knew what does that mean, the tone meeting? And she didn't know what that meant. And so we sat down together. And basically, it was me being Nancy Drew, and I had, like, you know, every scene I had tons and tons of questions to ask her about, as what Scott was saying, you know, what's the most important thing in the scene for you? You know, what's the point of the scene? Obviously, there were reasons for why the scenes were there, but I wanted to know what she saw and what was important to her, so that it stuck in my mind through all the different meetings, that by the time I was standing on the floor, I was going to make sure that I got that moment for her, because that was important. But what was great about working with her, because it was, the show was just getting started, was that she was super open to just hearing wacky, like what I would call, you know, everyone expects a director to always have wacky ideas, but and they get worried about it. Oh, no, here she comes. She's got that look on her face. But you know what I'm saying? Things that wouldn't slow the production down, but things that might add something cool to the episode. And on that particular show, the reason it was so fun was that they let you. They kind of said, well, what do you want? What are you seeing aside from all these things? What would you like to do? What are some things you're imagining? And I would just start thinking about feature film kind of ideas that could be done simply and quickly.
Sure.
And they would accommodate it. So it was just that information stage, figuring out what people wanted, and then trying to execute that as well as I could.
And is there a difference with genre or the format of the show to you?
In some of the technical requirements of the shows, but the broad strokes of what prep consists of seem pretty similar. You know, they're not genre dependent, I don't think. One of the biggest things that changed for me, or felt like a healthy development for me, was the understanding that certainly early on in prep, I had the right to say I don't know a lot. Early on, when people, you know, prep, there are a lot of departments that want a lot of answers very quickly. And sometimes you've just shown up, it may be the first episode you've done, and you'll, early on I would have questions asked of me, and every time a question was asked, I thought, well, that means I have to have an answer. And over the process, over the passage of time, I just started to understand that it was really okay to say, I don't know yet. I don't know. I need, you know, I'll know on day 3 of prep or 4, but not day 1 or 2. and the people that want to have their checklist of like, this is done. Inevitably, there'll be those things that they need the lead time on, and you have to have some idea. But oftentimes, it's just a matter of people in various departments wanting to be able to say, you know, got this done, don't have to worry about this anymore. And to commit to those things that early on day one versus day five, will box you into something that you'll be sorry you had an answer for.
Right. Yeah. I find the most challenging thing with prep is you are spending most of your daytime hours answering everybody else's questions. Getting on the moving train as you speak, and then I find it at night is when I have to kind of reabsorb the episode myself. I remember Anthony Hopkins at one point just said, somebody asked him about his prep as an actor, he just like, I just read the script like 100 times. And there was something that made a lot of sense about that. And it's like, you're right, we can break it up. And, you know, I used to break it up into all kinds of different things. And it got to the point where I was like, no, you know what I do at night? I read the script again because it's been broken up into a million pieces during the day and I got to put it back together again. And if I don't do that, I find that the knowledge I had of the script at the beginning of prep is gone by the end of prep because it's been 8 days since I've read the damn thing from beginning to end. And it's been broken up into a bunch of different little questions and stuff. So nighttime, just about reading the script again. If I can get a good 6 to 8 reads of that script in an 8-day prep, then I'm pretty prepped. And I'll have better answers for those things later in the game.
One good point about that I always, at least for myself, is I do not take for granted the very first time I read my script, even though it might go through many different changes and revisions, because I will never have fresh eyes again. And so for me, the first time I read it, it's the first time, it's the clearest I am in terms of my own instincts, that I can hear them loud and clear. So I kind of really pay attention to that first time I'm reading and I make notes to myself, because it's hard to hear your own voice sometimes and your own instincts after all those meetings start to happen and things start going, you know, you can get really distracted from the basic through lines, the basic story points that you're trying to tell, and you can kind of get all caught up in shiny things over here. But the first read, super important.
I was going to say that because, yeah, in prep, there is a lot of distractions from what I would say is the ultimate thing, is getting ready for tracking those red threads that track through the thing, and as well as how they connect to what came before and how they're going to connect moving forward. So moving into my next question, and this will probably inform kind of our role in the modern hierarchy of television production, and that is, what is our responsibility as far as story and script is? When you get handed a script and you come into prep and you read it, you've done your homework about the show, you understand that it filters through the vision of a showrunner. What are our responsibilities as far as script and story concern? What is that?
It really depends on the showrunner.
In what way?
There's showrunners that you can go to and say, this doesn't quite work for me. And there's showrunners that will, as you open your mouth and point to the thing you have highlighted, go, absolutely not.
Right.
and your strategy from that point on is very, very, very different.
Right.
Our job is to tell the story. And I find a lot of what we end up doing, the scenes that work are great. They sometimes stage themselves. You spend a lot of time working on the things that don't quite work and finding a way to make them work. And
a new set of eyes.
Yeah, and ideally you can address that at a script level, but sometimes you can't. And you have to come up with your own solutions for it.
Yeah, because after all, they have the writer's room, which is a factory all on their own. So they're pumping out ideas and stuff like that.
They're already 2 weeks ahead of you.
Exactly. And any question you might have said, maybe they've already thought of, who knows. But I was curious to see if anybody had any kind of separate point of view on perhaps what our role could be, given all the respect of the writer's room and the showrunner and the overall vision. Is there anything else that we can contribute to that?
I think you can contribute a huge amount in terms of brokering the communication about what's going on with boots on the ground when you're filming. You know, oftentimes the writer's room is 1,000 miles away from where the show's being shot, mm-hmm. and the location that you've gotten simply doesn't allow a piece of stage direction or an opening or closing to a scene that in the writer's room made sense, but in the one available location that would work can't be done. And so communicate that as well as you can and come up with possible solutions for those kinds of problems. And most of the time people are, when they hear what the obstacles are, or won't insist on, well, just do the thing that doesn't work anyway. Although that will happen on occasion, but it's much more often people go like, thanks, and that sounds like a viable solution, or how about this, or
shoot it both ways.
Yeah, shoot it both ways.
That's good. That's great. That's great. It's nice to see others' perspectives on that, and I'm sure there'll be some folks in the audience that could add to that as well. Let's move ahead. Let's start getting into shooting now. You've had your 7, 8, 9 days of prep. You've gotten everything ready, and you're on the floor now for your first day of shooting. Let's talk about some of the approach just to shooting as far as what do you prioritize, and what kind of tools you like to bring to it. We'll get closer. I want to keep the acting component maybe a little separate at first, and then we could talk about acting and our approach to acting in a second. But new guy in school, new kid in school, you come to a new show, you've prepped your thing, and you see a bunch of new faces, let's say, on a new show, because that tends to be where our skills are tested the most. Once they know you, you get a little, it gets a little easier. But what are some of the techniques to gain rapport with the crew, or what are some of the tools that you use to shoot a successful television show?
I guess for me, it's funny. Like when I read a script, I always look at what's going to be my visual motif, and what's the overall theme, and how can I look at that visually? And then once I have, it could even be like some overall metaphor. I find production designers and DPs, they love that shit. Like once they can creatively dive into it and see that we're actually looking at elevating the material, even if it's a little subversive, it's just something that it just gets them excited, and for me that creates this kind of team effort that we're gonna look at a way of just kind of raising the bar a little bit. So that's part of my job with all the personalities is getting people excited.
Nice.
So I that's what I do.
Make your first day.
Yeah, that's a big one.
Definitely make your first day.
Okay, how do you do that?
Plan A, plan B,
it's
plan C.
Planning, perhaps that's where your assistant director might come in handy, right?
Yeah.
Give ourselves a day.
Yeah, I try to have an easier day, hopefully, because they're getting used. I'm trying to fit into the machine. They're trying to figure out, oh my God, who's this person now? I've always wondered how crews deal with that when suddenly, oh, now there's this person, and now there's this person, and we're the ones who are in the kind of rotating doorway, right? So try and make my first day, definitely. Try and maybe, don't fix it if it's not broken, because the crew doesn't want to see that happening. But also try something interesting, hopefully you've met with a DP beforehand, before you've actually stood on set with them, and maybe work through something interesting for your first day that excites him, excites her, excites the crew, but is achievable. So basically have fun. I mean, I like to introduce myself when I show up on set, or sometimes have someone introduce me, but make some sort of embarrassing little gung-ho Mary Tyler Moore speech, throw my hat up, and they're like, here she is, okay, let's go. But have fun, basically try and have fun and look like you know what you're doing.
Cool. I go out of my way to make sure that people understand I want what they have. I need what they have. I think there's a huge amount of expertise in any given crew. And a lot of the time, I think a byproduct of tension or insecurity will be, acting like you've got everything under control and you don't need anybody's guidance or input. And the more experience I get, the more willing I am to just say, what do you got? I want what you have. I want your ideas. It inevitably will elevate anything I planned in a vacuum, and it does get people engaged also, and when people are engaged, the work has a chance to become surprising for everybody.
Cool. Yeah, they give you the keys to the bus, but the crew's not on the bus. You have to get them on the bus.
Mm-hmm. That's a great way to put it. Yeah, that's awesome.
Or drive alone.
Drive alone.
The other thing that's funny is some shows, you don't even read the scene before you start shooting it. Like, for God's sakes, have one read-through. I mean, some scenes are massive, but, you know, a lot of directors get really antsy, or ADs are, like, dancing around going, oh, my God, you're reading the scene, but we're not doing anything.
Actors love it when you read the scene.
But you got to read the scene. You got to read the scene, and you, to me, it's just, you know... And you start to feel it. You get it up on its feet.
It helps me, too, because it's the first time I've heard the scene.
Exactly.
I've been reading in my
head. With everyone. The release.
Any kind of rhythmic decisions I've been making are based on that first reading.
Yeah.
And I also know who's got their lines down, who do I shoot first. I get so much information out of that first reading.
And classically, a lot of times, if you're shooting in a studio and the showrunner wants to be there, they're usually there your first day because they want to see what's going to happen. But if they start to leave and they're working on other, episodes, a lot of times, like George would show up always for the first read-through just to hear. Because if something's not working, that's the person who's going to be able to make those calls about what can be changed, what can be, eased through. Can we lose this line? Can we change this? Actors have certain questions. And in a lot of cases, we don't have really the authority to make that call. And sometimes, as you're saying, the writer's room is, another time zone away, and the cell phones come out and the whole thing. So having as many of those people there who can make that call and you hear it is really, really beneficial. It just allows the machine to start moving,
Cool. Okay, let's move into let's get Scott's clip ready. We have a clip that Scott brought that I think reflects one of the topics.
The Isaac clip. Well, we were
Chris
talking.
Isaac, yeah.
We were talking about the role of the director, and I mentioned briefly that a lot of times I spend time in prep figuring out the problems. I mean, in a feature, you've been there from the inception. Maybe you're writing it. If there are problems, you've missed them. But it's so, kind of a part of you by the time you get to the shoot. And in television, you're handed the script and you have to quickly catch up. And there are scenes that stage themselves, and then there are the things I call like three couples meet in the hallway. That, in the speed of television, right? They've in here, three couples meet in a hallway.
Three couples meet
in
a hallway.
And you'll spend a week and a half, how the fuck do I stage three couples meeting in a hallway? And you'll spend all your time thinking about that. So that's happened to me probably 200 times. And this clip is actually one of my favorite times, which was on the Chris Isaac show 14 years ago. And the scene I was handed was, very, very quickly, the episode is about a faded guitar player, famous guitar player who's gone to rehab and come back. And Chris Isaac has hired him as a guitar tech because he loves the guy and wants to help him out. And halfway through the episode, he invites him on stage. And Jimmy Vane, the guitar player, upstages Herschel, Chris Isaac's guitar stage.
Right.
And the whole episode turns on this. So he becomes a nightmare. It turns into a big thing. And the challenge I had was, there's a good surprise coming up here, was that I had a guitar player who was phenomenal. Herschel is an amazing guitar player, maybe the best guitar player I've ever met. Mm-hmm. But not much of an actor, and definitely sort of hung back in the thing. And I had an amazing actor, one of the best I've ever worked with, Mr. Adam Arkin.
How ironic is that?
Who did not play guitar. And it did, so we got the guitar player who'd stand outside the frame and actually play live guitar. We saw that music live. But I knew that it didn't matter how good that guy's guitar solo was, and how good Adam's, finger playing, fake guitar playing was, that there was no way I could sell, he just upstaged that guy.
Right.
With just a guitar solo. There was no way I could do that. And it took me a long time to figure out what it was. And in the end, it was a cigarette and a long note and taking advantage of Adam's ability to play a crowd, which was something that Herschel never did. And those two things got me the scene, still one of my favorite scenes I've ever done.
That's cool. All right, let's...
That's cool. You're in the scene.
Let's see it. Playback!
Adam is the one who really didn't see this one coming.
Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome.
That's great. Well
done. And what's really coincidental. Oh, he's great. It's really coincidental when we knew Adam was coming here, and I bumped into Scott and I said, that clip, man, he can really play guitar, man. I mean, he can. And we didn't know Adam was coming today. This was yesterday. We didn't know Adam was coming today. So it's a pretty wild coincidence. That's a lot of fun.
Very cool.
Let's chew up Lynne's clip now. And we can get into, before we get to questions here, which we want to get on here pretty quick, probably, in my opinion at least, one of the main reasons we're obviously there, and that is to be, you know, the getting the story told, being representing the showrunner, but also being there for the actors, to be their support and to help them go through their experience as best they can. So let's start talking about acting, and as far as just general overview as far as approach to the actor.
Can I
and
ask
we'll show your clip.
I want to ask Adam what he wants us all to answer.
That's a great, that's actually, you know, not to put you on the mark, but that's interesting, because whenever I go to a new cast, oftentimes I say, what is it you want from your director? So maybe that's a good thing to...
Boy, that's a really complicated question. I know one thing that I want from directors is honesty regarding what their needs are. Something that I have never, something I've already struggled with is when I feel like I'm being handled in a way where an idea of how the actor works is being implemented in order to just get a simple directorial need out of the way. So if you need me to cross two lines sooner because it will help you get a master that won't require five extra pieces of coverage, let me in on the process. Now, there's some actors that might be thrown by that and they don't want to hear anything about it, but I would much rather hear that as an actor than have somebody invent a motivation for me that they don't need to get in my head about. Because I can figure out a way to make that work if I know what the technical requirements of the shot are. And then I guess somewhere the ability to, even if you're not, if I'm not giving the director what they need, at least understand why the choice was made in the first place in order to be able to steer it somewhere else. So to be able to say to someone, when I am directing an actor, I'll try to make it clear that I understand the validity of the choice they made. And rather than frame it in terms of like, let's get rid of that and do this instead, frame it in terms of let's add to what you're doing another element. And I guess it's just a more positive, a more positive approach that doesn't make me feel as an actor like I'm creating a problem or an obstacle with what I brought in. I don't know if that makes sense.
That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Actually, that's very sage. I really think that makes a lot of sense.
I think 90% of it is the staging. I mean, in some ways, a lot of people talk about directing actors as if it's about their character. And you know, most television actors after 5 years of the series know exactly what their character is. And I almost never give direction about character. I give direction about the scene, about some beat in the scene or something that thing. But the best thing I can do is come with a staging, or at least work out a staging with them that best unlocks that scene. And I know when I watch television and there's something about it that I don't like, 9 times out of 10, those actors are standing too close to each other or too far away, or you know, this scene would have been better if they were moving, or you know, and really that's what you bring to it. You say, how does this scene work in its staging? And you hand that to them and maybe throw an idea at the end, but 90% of it for me is in the stage.
That's interesting you say that, because it kind of harkens back to the overall, what is our role or our contribution inside this thing, right?
It's not
starts to get crystallized.
To park and honk on, right?
Right, yeah. It kind of crystallizes what our role is, you know, exactly, especially on an established show where the actors are very confident in their day-to-day choices they make with their characters.
And sometimes you have to kind of, you know, dig a ditch and sort of hope that they walk into it, you know? Do you feel like moving on this line? You
know?
And, you know, because you want them, you know, an actor is nothing if they can't own what they're doing.
Yes.
So they have to own it. So it's an interesting kind of balance. Actually, it's my favorite part. I kind of like finding that balance with them. It's kind of like a dance. And half, more than half the time, something else will come up during the staging that's like, oh, that's way better. Let's do that.
Yeah, cool. You know?
But just an approach and understanding to staging what that does for actors and the scene, I think, is really important.
That's great. Before we show your clip and then get on to questions, maybe you could kind of set it up a frame.
Sure. I was going to add to that. I think watching, like really listening and watching what they're doing, is the best thing you can do as a director. Instead of trying to go run in there and impose your vision, like just watch it unfold in front of you. So you've got plans, A, B, C, whatever. Who cares if something else comes there and is just be able to see it and it's right in front of you. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes people get entrenched. So that would probably be the big thing for me. But yeah, okay, so to set this up, again, this is also a show that I did a long time ago. But I think directors get hired for different reasons. And at that time, I was getting hired because I was known for doing like sexual content or deviant kind of stuff, etc. I don't know. And this was a scene where two characters had been flirting with each other, and this scene was supposed to be super hot. They're supposed to be making out like gangbusters. They finally get together. It's supposed to be like this explosion, and it's in a church. And in the script, it was almost like that thing where it says, you know, when they won the war. It wasn't really described what was going to happen, so I had a lot of leeway. Yay, hotness in a church, that's something, I don't know. So what ended up happening was one of the characters is a PA. She's got her first job as a PA on a video shoot, and this band is playing, and these two characters meet, and then they kind of go off together to talk. And I'll show you the scene, and then I'll talk a little bit about how we got there, because unfortunately, we started to shoot the scene, and it was just dead. The two women hadn't really met before. There was no chemistry whatsoever. They barely wanted to touch each other. It was just one of those days where everything was kind of in place, but that wasn't working. And so I'll just show you the scene, and then I can tell you a little bit about how we got there.
Cool.
We have beer.
No, that's okay. You know, you don't want to get involved with anybody, and that is cool.
I'm glad it's cool. Man.
It's totally cool.
Well, it doesn't mean that we can't fuck.
You want to fuck me?
Very good. That's from the L word, right?
That's from
the L word.
That's the moment we can all relate to, right? You're making out, the radio goes off, So what ended up happening was the way it was supposed to work was they'd start this conversation and they go around the back of the church and there's this stained glass or this window and they have this negotiation, etc. And then it kind of explodes into them making out. But it really wasn't happening, and so a couple of things happened. One was one of the actors just said to me, what is it? It was interesting hearing you talk about, like, what does the director want here? And I said, what I want is that there's, like, you know, you just want to grab her and pull her inside your body, well, what do you mean by that? And I was trying to explain it verbally. And finally, one of them just said, just do it to me. And I'm like, okay, just pardon me, folks. And I just grabbed the other woman and started doing what they were doing. And she allowed me to, which, you know, you gotta ask, right? And then they sort of, oh, like that. And I was like, yeah, exactly. So we shot that. So you saw that when we come around the other side. But I also realized prior to this that there might be some issues. So I shot that shot through the window, sort of like pushing in to get you inside the intimacy of that, not letting you see what's actually going on. So making the audience want to see more. And then using the intercutting of the rock band that was playing as a way to heighten the kind of juiciness of the scene. So that was something that I shot as well, thinking we're gonna need to juice this up a little bit. Because if I had just shot what was there, it wouldn't have had the same, you know? But sometimes you don't know that until you get there.
Did having the barrier between them and camera free them up also as well?
Yeah.
Was that like so when liberating?
We did the first blocking and they were really worried about things, and then I did that thing with them, and then I said, okay, well, but just to warm it up, let's just shoot from this side first, and then they were tweaking the lighting for us to come around, and that gave them some time to get there. So, but it was that thing of filmmaking where you can put the scene together in your head and think, you know, how am I going to communicate this if that's not coming from them? So even if we had never cut on the other side of the glass, it still could have been, we could have pushed all the way in on the glass side, and the scene still would have worked. Anyway, there you go.
It's a little Shakespeare in Love, right? It's a mystery. So the alchemy of all the things we've been talking about so far, how they come together, there's the one side of be ready, and then don't be ready.
Exactly.
Which is one of my old improv teachers' first thing is, don't be ready. You know, very Zen kind of approach. We could go on forever, I know, with the different topics. I got tons here, but I think it's probably fair that we open it up to the audience now and see if we can get some questions for folks on our panel. So feel free to grab the mic and ask some questions.
Hi there. Is this on? Hello? Yeah. Hi. I wanted to have your input on, I'm developing a story that potentially could be a feature for theatrical release or a television movie. Now, when you're developing a story, do you recommend that from the beginning, would you set it up differently if it was gonna go to a network television or theatrical release? Or can you change your mind later?
I think they're very different animals, really. I mean, the most simple way I can put it is features have endings, and television series have to continue to open up.
MOW.
Oh, a television movie. Oh, a theatrical versus a MOW?
That's right, yeah.
They're close.
Jason, yeah.
They're close. I write quite a bit of MOWs and features, and I find that the only difference, honestly, is like a 7 or 8 act structure. But you can actually take out those commercial breaks and still have a feature. So, but knowing the way the market is and knowing for any writers out there, the easiest thing to break into by far is writing movies of the week. So I would definitely write it as a movie of the week. The chances of that going into production, it's tenfold easier than a feature right now. So I would, without a doubt, I would do it as an MOW.
Thank you.
There you go. I wanted to touch on the situation that Lynne described, where it seemed very practical and very logical to sort of get all the directors there and introduce him and sort of talk about the story arc all together. It seemed like that would be very conducive to have everyone on the same page and you know, help smooth things out. I was curious, I mean, there must be, of course, millions of reasons why, but why wouldn't that be a bit more of a standardized practice to get everyone on board and, you know, have a director be welcomed sort of from day one, sort of thing?
Well, most people are busy and coming in from other places, so we had the advantage that everyone was in town for that particular day. And, you know, we were never able to do it again. I met with everybody on some level from that point on, but the only time that all four or five of us were available to four of us were available to hang out. It was that day that everybody was there to watch Martha do her thing. So I think it's actually practical things that keep it in the way. Though as a director, if I can get out somewhere early so I can spend a bit more time on set than usual, I will. And it's usually the first thing I want to do. You know, they're always trying to put you in a location van or in a casting room, and I'm like, no, just let me go to set. I just want to go to set.
I think some shows do that more now, where they know well enough in advance which directors they're going to hire for their season. And I'm seeing more shows kind of hire fewer directors and give them more episodes, so there's maybe more continuity of voice. And they've all had their, it's not like they've got 13 new directors for a 13 episode show. They've got four directors, let's say, and they're going to rotate. And so that way, theoretically, there's more of an opportunity potentially to have a consistency and have people together at the same time, and then maybe have those people chime in on things, you know, creatively, if that's what the showrunner wants. But it seems to me I'm seeing more of that in general.
And as a young director, when you were starting, especially nowadays, there's so many different directors that inspire you, and there's so many great films that you can have access to. How do you find your style, and how do you tell a story your way, and trusting yourself that this is your style, and not being, you know, trying to be original and truthful to who you are as a director and why you're doing it. So how do you find your style as a director, as a new director, and how do you keep it?
I guess it's all about discovering your own style. From my experience, I ended up starting with music videos and short films, and I've always had themes that I've always explored. And that's how I, and some of those themes do pop up in my MOWs, and especially in my feature. It just took me a while to get around to it, but I think you definitely need your own voice, I think. Although, that being said, yeah, with television, you definitely have to adapt to the showrunner, and you gotta make them happy, ultimately, if you wanna continue working with them, and you gotta be very collaborative with your vision.
I've never thought in terms of specifically, you know, developing a style per se. I feel like style is a byproduct of your taste and your experience and the circumstances you find yourself in. And over the course of time, if I look at past work of mine, I'm aware of a style that has kind of developed, but it was never something I was consciously working on from the outside in, you know, thinking in terms of, you know, I want this style. There are filmmakers who have inspired me and who consciously and subconsciously, I guess I aspire to, but not from the standpoint of wanting that to be my style necessarily, but just because it's a vocabulary that makes sense to me, or an assortment of tools that feels familiar in some way.
As I was saying earlier, the costume aspect of a TV series,
I find in some ways, the last thing a television series wants is my style. What they want me to do is to figure out what their style is and work within it. And out of that, I learn a lot. But it's actually one of the things I really enjoy. I like sort of going onto a show and trying to figure out what its particular costume is, and can I wear it, and how will I wear it. And it's a subtle thing, but almost never have I been asked, unless you're doing a pilot, in which case then it's the reverse, to create on top of their style something that's me.
Color outside of the lines.
Yeah, I mean, there's exceptions to that. I remember Peter Mitchell once, I worked on Cold Squad, who's, you know, one of the guys who got me into television, a really, really great, one of the great showrunners in this country, you know, came to me on the first day and says, this script's a little short. So, you know, that little montage thing, and a little Scott Smith in there would be kind of nice. And it was like, oh my God, I've been given, you know, it was all about those 2 minutes. So there's exceptions to this. But, you know, it's one of the things I kind of like. It's like, okay, what are we doing now?
Interesting. Good.
Can I just chime in on that? I'd say the best thing you can do is to start honing your craft and then figuring out what your thing is, you know, like where your strengths are, especially the more you work, the more you're going to realize what your thing is, and your thing being your strength. Like, what are you bringing to the table? Like, why did you get hired among all? Like, it's very competitive to get into television. There's so many options for producers, great, talented people to work with. Why did they hire you? You know, why you specifically? And then bring that, you know, fold in, but bring that if you can.
Just one other note to add, I think, is not a visual style, but just your own style, especially working with actors. That's another way that that's going to develop, I think, as well. I'm very collaborative when I work with actors, and luckily within the MOW realm, we do have opportunities of working with dialogue a little bit more and ad-libbing, which I absolutely love to do, aside from having to deal with the writer's room. So that gives me a little bit more of almost working within an indie feature, but it happens to be for directing for television. And sometimes that's why some directors, they kind of stick to doing that model compared to maybe episodic working with a showrunner.
I was going to say thank you again for coming out and speaking to us. My question is sort of related to what you were saying, but because in TV, traditionally, a writer to get into a room would write a spec or something along those lines. I wanted to know what you guys think young directors should be doing in order to be able to get those that first gig, which you don't want to, you know, mess up. But I think getting that first gig is, like you said, there's a lot of competition. So how do you recommend separating yourself from the pack?
That's the big question, isn't it?
Make something get some attention to start. Nobody will hire you because you're a nice person. But they will hire if they love the thing that they saw that you did.
Yeah,
even
a document.
If it's 3 minutes long. And if that thing that you did is somehow lined up with their show in a way that they can go to bat for you, because no one person decides to bring you on board, or if they do, they have to go to bat for you with a bunch of other people, that they're somewhat aligned. But it's alchemy. I still don't know how.
I think every one of us probably has a different path.
Yeah.
That led the way, and it's all serendipitous things and relationships.
It's like a piece of work, a champion, a busy town.
Yeah.
Some good timing. Those four things will conspire.
Yeah. And luck.
And relationships with actors as well. Yeah. A lot of times, the actors you've worked with on your little indie project end up becoming huge and are on huge series, and they basically want to bring you on a show. Mm-hmm. So that's a possibility.
Be nice to actors.
Yes.
I'm wondering how much the.
We'll turn it up for you.
I'm wondering how much control or input you have in general into the edit of an episode.
2 days.
According to the DGC.
It totally depends on the show, actually.
Four if you're DGA, two if you're DGC. Yeah.
I looked it up, guys. It's four.
DGA,
is it four?
Yeah. DGA is four.
For DGC? Yeah, DGC. DGA is four for sure.
You have 4 days to submit your cut. And your cut is your cut. You can do whatever you want with it. You're wise to try and figure out, you know, what the style and the flow of the show is. But that's sort of your domain to do with your footage what you wanted to do. And I'm sure everybody's had the same experience of you know, turning in director's cuts that remain virtually unchanged between when you turn them in and when they air, and having cuts that get modified tremendously, either because of, you know, stylistic choices that they weren't in agreement with, or sometimes there are story elements that have shifted from the time you've submitted your episode to what they've discovered they have to do with the continuing arc of the show. And so there's restructuring that goes on that you were totally unaware of when you did your cut.
And sometimes they just have to cut it themselves. It's like I don't run into this as much anymore, but every once in a while I do. I used to describe being on a show as like the only 7 days in the entire production cycle from writing the script to delivering the last mix that a showrunner has to give up the baby and give it up entirely is the 7 days that you get the baby. And when the baby's, when you're done with the baby, when those 7 days are up, they want that fucking baby back. They want it back now. And so And yeah, there's shows where you deliver the cut, and they're like, "I hate the edit room. This is great. I love it." And there's ones where they're like, "You know, we love your cut, but I have to do a cut." And they'll go and they'll do a cut from minute one because they have to. It's the only way they can see themselves through the process and everything in between. So I always just try and make sure that any ideas I had are kind of up front so they can see them, and that the takes are best. I find it really hinges on how good the editor is in selecting takes, because you'll burn through that 4 days or 2 days or whatever it is really fast if they haven't picked the best takes.
Yes.
And you'll spend all your time just pulling out the performance you know is there.
Plus, the editors know a lot about what the producers want when they get in the room, because they've already done X number of episodes with them. So a lot of times, you know, I've been in the chair with the editor, and as I'm wanting to trim this, been dying to trim this line or trim the, they're just going, they're kind of going to me, I wouldn't be going there, Lynn. You know, like they are going to want to hear every single word. So sometimes, most of the time, you know, you deliver your cut slightly long so that the producers can trim some of it, and they give it to the broadcasters and they have at her as well. So I think, you know, if I were wearing those shoes, I too would want to know why they wanted to cut that line out, and therefore I'd want to hear it anyway, and only to discover, yeah, it didn't really work. But I would need to hear it. If I had written it, I would probably want the same thing, you know. So try and put in everything. You know, your responsibility as a director is to shoot the script. You know, you're not supposed to be taking stuff out, and you're not supposed to be adding stuff in. If you are, you better make sure you got what they had on the page. That's your job, right? So.
Although I've also had the experience where if a show's been written really fat and your cut, even when you've tried to keep it lean, is coming in, you know, 10 minutes over, there have been situations where there's a resentment that you haven't allowed them. Like, why didn't you find what was really fat about the writing or a scene that might have not been necessary? Because oftentimes their time between when they do the producer's cut and get it on the air is limited. And so there can sometimes be an appreciation that you've done some of that work for. It, again, it just so much depends on the style of the show.
Everyone's different. You sort of have to find
out
what their expectations are. Then, I agree.
Couple of more questions. I think we're getting close to the end. That's it? Aw.
What?
Too bad.
But we have more to say.
And it just lined up perfectly with a little reception outside. So thank you, Jason Bourque, Lynne Stopkewich, Adam Arkin, and Scott Smith. I had a great time. Hope you guys had a great time too. Thank you, DGC, for setting this up. Directors Guild of Canada. Woo-hoo.